You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh on this Monday, back to school, back to work. It is October 14th, 2024. It is a great day to be a Wisconsinite. Now 6 past the hour of 12 noon. Mr. Zommer is glad to have you along. We're back in it for another week.
Yes, we are. And how was your kayaking this weekend?
Thank you so very much for asking. For those who tuned in on Friday, you might recall that I got into kayaking a few years ago.
It's so fun.
It's fantastic. And for two reasons. And growing up, I don't know why I had this in my head. You know, a lot of misconceptions in my head growing up, I guess. You see the movies or other places, I guess, kayaking people going, like, wearing helmets and going upside down underwater through violent rapids. And you're like, I couldn't do that. That's crazy. Well, that's just like extreme kayaking out west or something. Most kayaking in Wisconsin is very tranquil and fun, and you could do it in a lot of different places around the state. So my father, my two godsons, as we say in Spanish, mi compadre, actually mi compadres, his wife, Florcy, Kurt and Florcy got me. They said, yeah, this is fun. You got to do it with us. And then I worked at L.L. Bean for a while. Big outdoor company, great company here in Madison and around the country. And they sold kayaks. And the great thing about L.L. Bean is they give their employees outside time, they call it. I think it's 16 hours every year. And you can divide that up. And all you got to do is take a picture of your, you know, you schedule it and say, hey, I'm going to take outdoor time tomorrow for 4 hours or 6 hours or whatever. And you got to take a picture of you doing something outside. Kayaking, hiking, butterfly watching, bird, anything. And you send it to your manager and you get paid for up to 16 hours a day to get outdoors, which I always thought was a great thing for this, for a company to do. So between those two things, between working L.L. Bean and my friends, Kurt and Florcy, I got into kayaking a few years ago. And so we go all kinds of places here in Southwest or South Central Wisconsin, primarily like, you know, the, Bad Fish Creek, going by Stoughton there. Also, Sugar River. That's where I was on Friday. Kurt and I did the Sugar River just north of Paoli. And let me tell you, it was spectacular. The weather was perfect. It was around high 70s to around 80. A little bit of a wind.
Good time to be in the water.
Right? And you're just floating for the most part. And there's a little bit of a ripple rapid here and there, but nothing severe. And it, for me, I think we all have a hobby, or most of us have some kind of a hobby that we do that kind of lets us release and forget about life. And that's what I do when I'm on a creek or on a river and just floating. And it's amazingly therapeutic and clarifying. So, and I'm glad you asked this, Somers, because today happens to be Columbus Day / Indigenous Peoples Day. For many years, while I was growing up, you celebrated it as Columbus Day. You know, oh, Columbus discovered America. It turns out there were people here before Columbus, as it turns out.
Just a bit before.
And so now a lot of people celebrate it as Indigenous Peoples Day. Because I was telling this to a friend over the weekend. One of my favorite political cartoons, and maybe I've said this before, are two Native Americans on perhaps Plymouth Rock on a shoreline, and they look out across the water to a colonial ship coming towards them. And the political artist drew on the side of the ship, you know, the Columbus or something on the sail. It says Columbus. And one Native American looks at the other Native American and he says, what do you think? Should we have a policy on immigration?
That's pretty good. That is, That's exactly the point. We're right? all immigrants unless you're Native American.
It's one of my, so I mean, I always think of that political cartoon on Columbus Day. And, but, you know, and then we had Dr. Rosenbro on the program last week. If you missed it, you can look at it as a podcast. The state archaeologist from the Great Wisconsin Historical Society talking about these canoes of indigenous people that they found here in Lake Mendota off the shores of Madison.
Yeah, it's the second hour of Thursday's show from, what day was Thursday? October 10th. Yeah. I definitely recommend it. Mm-hmm. It was really cool.
She was fantastic.
Those are some old canoes.
Old, hundreds, if not some of them thousands of years old, 3,000 years old plus.
I think 4,500 is the oldest one so far.
So far. And so I found myself traveling down the Sugar River on Friday in a beautiful, you know, plastic kayak, fiberglass kayak. I thought to myself, and I think Kurt and I said this to each other, because of conservation efforts in this state and in this region, we're able to float down these streams and waterways that look very similar to what indigenous native folks saw so very many years ago. And I thought about those canoes that Dr. Rosenbro talked about having been discovered here in Madison. And I guess it's just an opportunity on this Indigenous Peoples Day / Columbus Day to realize that whatever we're going through right now, whatever this is, and boy, let me tell you, it's something. Just remember, as the old saying goes, this too shall pass. All these ads and elections and one way or the other, this too shall pass. I, you know, when I say the kids, Dahmers, I mean you. This is a new one. I have heard it before, but I hear it more often now. Get out and touch the grass.
Yes, touch grass.
Touch grass.
Something very often used for. Mm-hmm. It's often used as an insult, like, wow, you are inside and clearly do not see reality.
Really?
Like, all just right. Go outside for once in your life, touch grass. But it also is a helpful reminder for all of us.
Yeah, right. And it literally means to just get outside and get grounded, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I touched some water, as it turns out, on Friday. But I think it's a really good reminder that on this day that we have a deep history that happened long before 1776 or 1642, goes back hundreds and thousands of years, a millennia, that people were on this land and settled this land and farmed this land and had a beautiful, long culture and heritage long before any white person from Europe ever set foot on it. And that should be celebrated as well. And no, we don't have to go back and, you know, I think it's good to know history, but it doesn't mean that the two histories are mutually exclusive, right? The America we live in today, one of the great parts of it is a melting pot for America. The atrocities that were put onto the Native Americans that were here are terrible and should never be forgotten. But as we sit here in 2024, the beauty of America in modern day is that we're a melting pot from around the world. And so that's why over the weekend I found some of these comments we're going to play for you today and go back over the weekend. More of the disturbing. But remember, as I said, what is it, 21 days, 22 days? What are we away, Zomers, from the election?
Not many.
There you go. Boy, up to the minute information from the All Ball Show. We're close.
22.
Thank you.
The 22nd day from today is the 5th.
The 22 days away from the election. We're going to get through it. Believe me, it's. I know there's a lot of us out here that are sick of this. That every time a radio or television ad comes on, you hit mute or you turn it off. I got you. And some of the atrocious, ridiculous, over-the-top things being said out there just make you sick, doesn't it? But be of good heart. Be of good cheer. Focus on your neighbors. Focus on your community and all the good things that are happening. And remember, those things shall endure long after November 5th. That's where I'm at today. 15 now past the hour of 12 noon. Glad to have you along with us. Going to start with a couple of clips here. Over the weekend, and building up to something here, polls coming out. And remember, polls don't vote. That's what Charles Franklin, our friend at Marquette Law School, likes to say. A lot of people ask you, why are things tightening up? Why is this race so close? Well, loss of critical thinking in the population explains why the current race for the presidency is so close. Advertising, entertainment have deliberately undermined people's ability to think in order to make them more efficient consumers. At the same time, our educational system, news media, and cultural values have developed into a competition for our attention rather than counterbalancing the influence of marketing and pushing the public to think more carefully. Right? What's sexy? What pops? What sizzles? There's all these things, our devices in our hands and radio and newspapers and magazines and video games, emails, texts. In order to get our attention, it has to pop. And the crazier it is, the more we'll listen to it. And it got crazier over the weekend. Donald Trump on the news show. Do we have time for this first one, Zomers? We'll do it when we come back.
The one that I sent you?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, here's Donald Trump. We'll talk about it in a second. Here's Donald Trump talking about what he thinks will happen on Election Day on Fox over the weekend.
Are you expecting chaos on Election Day?
No, I don't think so. Not from the side that votes for Trump. I think the bigger problem is the enemy from within, not even the people that have come in and destroying our country, by the way, totally destroying our country, the towns, the villages, they're being inundated. But I don't think they're the problem in terms of Election Day. I think the bigger problem are the people from within. We have some very bad people. We have some sick people, radical left lunatics. And I think they're the, and it should be very easily handled by, if necessary, by National Guard, or if really necessary, by the military, because they can't let that happen.
Handled by the military, if necessary, Trump says. Calling out the military. Talking about the enemy from within. Over the weekend saying that Russia and China isn't the problem, it's people, United States citizens. 855-752-4842. 855-7542. Back after this. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along with us here on a Monday, October 14th, 2024, 21 now past the hour of 12 noon. Donald Trump saying over the weekend that he would not rule out calling out not just the National Guard, the full-fledged military, if things don't go the way that he thinks they should go.
Specifically against what he calls the radical left.
Yes. And again, we're building up a narrative here. Not we. Trump. The MAGA folks. Talked to some people in the know over the weekend. Trump really isn't trying to win your vote at this point. He's building a narrative. And that narrative is to get as many people to think that he is basically a shoo-in as possible. Why do you think he went to California this weekend? Got no chance of winning California. Somebody told him about Coachella, the big music festival. Oh, geez, you get a big crowd out there.
That was a fiasco in and of itself.
That was like another fiasco. But he wanted a big crowd. What Donald Trump is most likely to do with J.D. Vance is declare victory at around 10 p.m. on election night, regardless of what reality is. Now, don't get me wrong. Is there a reasonable and realistic possibility that Trump Vance legitimately win? Yes, I believe there is. But is there an equal chance that Harris Walls also could legitimately win? Yes. My feeling is it's not going to matter what reality is, that Trump is setting this up so that MAGA and Trump will declare victory regardless on election night. And then we'll start calling on people to show up at election counting places, say that the vote should be stopped. They've won. Any other votes from here on out are fake. Try to create more chaos. Send it into the courts. And a long, drawn-out, chaotic battle will ensue. That's what he's really doing at this point. All this garbage, all of this incendiary dark rhetoric over the weekend, it's not meant to win, legitimately. It's meant to create chaos and excitement in his base so that the perception is he can point back at this and say, look, there's no way I couldn't have won. I didn't lose. There's no way I could lose. And then saying over Fox, that clip we played right before the break, blaming the left and saying that military action may be necessary. 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. Let's go to Mark in Prairie du Sac. Mark, thanks for calling. Let's see.
Well, to go back to earlier in conversation, you're talking about Columbia, Indigenous People Day. A couple of good books I can recommend is 1491, mm-hmm. which talks about the Americas prior to the Columbian, you know, event. That, and then 1493, which talks about the effects of the counter effects that the New World products, including agriculture crops and the silver and the gold that they came out that boosted the economy subsequent to, the European incursion into the New World and how disease just kind of wiped out whole populations before the Europeans even really ventured into the continents. But it is just unsurprising that Donald Trump doesn't seem to realize that, you know, regardless of the outcome of the election, you know, Joe Biden is still president until January of next year. Mm-hmm. And Trump just starts to get too hinky and calling for all this violent stuff, that there's nothing to stop Joe Biden at this point in time to activating, the military and, crushing down any kind of insurrection or rebellion, as George Washington was forced to do for the Whiskey Rebellion or the Shays Rebellion.
Yeah.
I mean, and actually leading the troops, as commander-in-chief. I mean, that...
Yeah.
It is Donald Trump is a clear and present danger to democracy itself, and that we have to call that out. And I hate to say denounce because that's got all kinds of connotations of what the commies did.
I think stand up at the ballot box. It just reiterates why every vote matters. And anybody who's thinking about sitting this one out, or I'm not excited, or I'm going to write in Jill Stein or any other third party candidate, that's all dangerous. That's all playing into the danger, correct?
Yeah, we have to play the game we're in, not the one we wish we were in.
Yeah.
Well, correct. And because Vladimir Putin is supporting Jill Stein.
I mean, right.
She's been over to Russia a few times and garnering support from Vlad the evil. And
I'm going to get Dick in. Thanks, Mark. Appreciate the call. 855-752-4842. Let's go quickly. Dick, listening on WMDX in Madison. Dick, thanks for holding. What's up?
Well, I love it. Everything that was just said, everything. And he build upon it even a little further, Mark, would be ask James Santella next time you have him on or next time you talk to him. I'm not going anywhere because let's create this scenario where he somehow, something really close happens, like 2000, it takes a long time to sort it out. We're not going anywhere, dude. And guess what? Your Supreme Court said we don't have to. And I'm above the law.
Right.
I'm talking about Biden now. We're not going anywhere.
Yeah,
so it's sorted out properly.
Right. And I hear you,
sick
Dick.
Of these people.
I hear you. And yes, I don't want to go to some dark place of an extreme thing going on, but I think the tendency to say, well, you know, the Supreme Court gave Trump all these unmitigated powers, and so now Biden can use that. I'm not saying he wouldn't, or I wouldn't necessarily support it, but I think the hope is you don't want to go down to that level. You don't want Biden to do something that he wouldn't normally do just to try to, you know, prevent Trump from stealing the election.
Yeah, I agree with you, but I see the scenario you're laying out more and more now, too, in that just like the last time, he's laying the groundwork for they stole it.
Right.
And he'll go out early and say, like he did in 2020. And here another thing shoved down his throat is in 2012, he actually said this because he thought Mitt Romney was going to win. And he said the worst thing possible in this country, Trump I'm talking about, is the Electoral College.
Yeah, right.
Isn't that funny?
Right. It is and it isn't, right? I mean, funny, but not in a ha-ha way. Yeah, you're right. Thank you very much, Dick. Really appreciate it. 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. Come back. Talk about more of this rhetoric that Donald Trump is using over the weekend. Other clips for you. Neil Katyal on Meet the Press, laying this out. What could happen on Election Day? This time, we need to be prepared. We'll tell you how on the other side. It's the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network for Monday, October 14th, 2024, 34 minutes now past the hour of 12 noon. Glad to have you along with us. Talk a little bit about news over the weekend. Trump comments. This rhetoric gotten darker over the weekend. Fascist rhetoric. I know there's people out there that are, Todd, why do you use that word? Look, you're ginning up, Todd, the rhetoric by using things like fascist rhetoric. I do know a little history. Our friend Matt Flynn, he likes to say, you're not woke, you're not woke. If you don't know history, you're not woke unless and until you know history. I know a little history. I'm not a history expert, but I know a little history. And I don't use, if you've been with this show, coming up is our second anniversary, by the way, next month. I don't use rhetoric like that or words like that without thinking about it most of the time. Look, I'm human, right? Here's the thing I would say. If you're bothered by me using the term fascist rhetoric, then perhaps the candidate you support should stop using fascist rhetoric. I mean, Trump literally uses the same verbiage and phrases in some cases, that Hitler used. You can't deny that. Poisoning our blood when talking about immigrants is the exact same line that Hitler used. Calling people vermin, exact same line that Hitler used. I'm not saying that Donald Trump is, quote unquote, is Hitler. I'm saying we've never had a presidential candidate in recent time, at least of a major party, that has used rhetoric repeatedly. Now you've had people, you know, I know history is politics enough to know over time, you know, you've had people that, you know, good or bad or otherwise, have used words or phrases. And after they've been caught and asked by reporters and a big story, they walk it back and say, look, that's not who I am. I made a mistake. And look, there by the grace of God, go I. I've certainly made mistakes in my life and will continue to do that. But a rational individual admits you made a mistake and then doesn't repeat it. Trump uses this rhetoric and gets called on it and then continues to use it without asking for forgiveness or admitting he was wrong. And that's where the concern comes from. It's like a classic authoritarian demagogue. Now, Trump is appealing to the disaffected, right? Trump seeks their loyalty by giving them a common enemy to blame. They feel displaced religiously, economically, culturally, even politically. And of course, he began this in 2015 with immigrants. Remember when he came down the escalator? Said, you know, most of these people, I'm paraphrasing, but used the term, this is a quote, rapists and murderers, unquote. And then added as a quick aside, some, I assume, are good people. And this anti-immigrant stance is still a primary enemy. At recent rallies, he's labeled immigrants, quote, animals, stone-cold killers, and the enemy from within, unquote. And now the shared enemy has broadened. He's putting a new groups of people into the enemy's list, including members of the LGBTQ community, the media, and now Democrats. Trump's extreme rhetoric is intended to unify supporters by demonizing the enemies as quote unquote evil. And if it comes down to it, deserving of violence. And this is where, again, we take a turn that we've never seen in modern day American politics from any major party candidate. Saying that some people might deserve to be beat up. Some people might deserve to be the point of violence. Trump understands that what the psychology is here involved. Yes, he has a lot of problems, but he does get some basic things. Remember, this is a guy who understands marketing, the apprentice program. He made a big hit at NBC. He knows how to grift. He knows how to sell. And he's locking in on that one big marketing point, loyalty. Loyalty. One of my favorite programs from years ago on Univision, Sábado Gigante, Big Saturday. They'd have, you know, Colgate, they call it in Spanish, Colgate toothpaste, Colgate. Well, you'd be disloyal if you weren't using Colgate to the program. It's the same principle here. To turn against Trump, a supporter would have to admit the enemies are not evil, but in reality, ordinary, well-intentioned people like themselves. At a Colorado rally over the weekend, Trump said, quote, "We have to live with these animals, but we won't live with them for long," unquote. A person in the crowd shouted, quote, "Kill them," unquote. I'm going to play for you again to reiterate what Trump told Fox News Channel host Maria Bartiromo over the weekend is even more troubling about these forthcoming elections, more troubling than what we just said about immigrants. Here's Trump again over the weekend.
I think the bigger problem is the enemy from within, not even the people that have come in and destroying our country. By the way, totally destroying our country. The towns, the villages, they're being inundated. But I don't think they're the problem in terms of election day. I think the bigger problem are the people from within. We have some very bad people. We have some sick people, radical left lunatics. And I think they're and it should be very easily handled by, if necessary, by National Guard, or if really necessary, by the military, because they can't let that happen.
Remember last week we played you a cut of Trump saying that it would be dangerous to have a Harris Walls sign in your yard? We don't want anybody to get hurt. Half joking. Neil Katal, former U.S. acting Solicitor General, an attorney, was on NBC over the weekend. Here's what he said. He's an attorney, great, insightful guy. Here's what he said over the weekend on NBC in terms of how what he's looking at as we move towards November 5th.
Those remarks from J.D. Vance are chilling over and over again, including saying there was a peaceful transfer of power. The vice president doesn't exactly have a technical impact in terms of certifying the election. But what are you, as you look at the potential here, what are you worried he could do?
Well, I think Vance is a barometer for the Republican Party. And you know me, I'm normally a voice of calm, and I'm here not as a voice of calm today. I think that what the vice president said, what Donald Trump has said, what members of the Republican Party have said leads me to think there is a coming massive crisis that's going to occur on November 5th with the election, in which even if Kamala Harris wins the election and wins those battleground states, the Trump team is going to declare victory with J.D. Vance at his side, and they will pressure courts, they will pressure state legislatures, they'll pressure state governors, and they'll pressure the United States Congress to throw out the popular vote and get this election through shenanigan.
Neil Cattell, former U.S. Solicitor, or acting Solicitor General, with Jen Psaki on NBC over the weekend. He's not a guy who deals in hyperbole, or as he said, he's usually tries to kind of put a calm blanket of reality on rhetoric. And I'm not here to scare you today, right? It's Monday. Good Lord. We got all week here. I don't want to start off the weekend putting people into, you know, the scared mode. Not meant to scare us, but it's meant to face the reality. I mean, one of the things that happened in 2016 and then 2020 is that I think that folks underestimated Trump and Trumpism. Oh, it's really not that bad. It's just Trump being Trump. It's just words. He won't actually govern that way. Look, I mean, he'll lose peacefully in 2020 and that'll be that. But we know from Liz Cheney and Adam Kinzinger, Republicans that were on that January 6th bipartisan committee, that Trump knew exactly what he was doing, and the people around him knew. And I think that Neil Cattell is absolutely right. The more I listen to my sources. And again, I'm not here. I'll make it very clear. I'm not saying that it's a done deal, that there's no way that Trump could legitimately win. He could. And in fact, I think that's why I'm starting the week and why I'm starting the show this way. Because one of the things I saw on socials over the weekend, which gave me great concern, was from progressive liberals who are upset that Kamala Harris has been inclusive with more thoughtful, principled conservatives like Liz Cheney, who are upset that Kamala Harris had the audacity to say over the weekend that she wanted someone from the Republican Party in her cabinet. And that somehow Kamala Harris doesn't pass the litmus test for progressives. So they want to take their ball and go home. We have perhaps, well, not perhaps, we have a chance to elect the first black woman in American history to the White House. If you're a progressive, if that doesn't excite you, I don't know. And you can say, well, you know, you can say the same thing about Nikki Haley. She's a black woman or a woman of color too. And, you know, I certainly wouldn't vote for Nikki Haley. I get it. But Kamala Harris is no Nikki Haley. If you look at her politics, she's had progressive politics the majority of her life. And now she's ascending, trying to ascend to the highest office in the land and saying, look, you have to be, when you get to this level and you want to be president of the United States, most people don't get there without creating a coalition. Look at Joe Biden. I mean, he uses the word consequential all the time, but he's right. One of the most consequential presidents we've ever had in our lifetime. In terms, you'll talk to guys like Rick Smith, a big union guy whose program is on this network every night. We talked to him at the Democratic National Convention, saying, you know, he had his doubts about Biden. Now, he wasn't the first or second or even third choice for Rick Smith in 2020. But he supported him once he became the general nominee and said, you know what? I was kind of wrong about Biden because he's done more for progressives and progressive causes and union causes than guys like Obama or Clinton. But Biden got there by creating a coalition. And that's what Kamala Harris is doing. Really smart politics. And I'm bringing some of this stuff up with Trump today and what could possibly be coming on November 5th. Because what I don't want to have happen is having my progressive Democratic friends on the night of November 5th or on Wednesday, November 6th, marching up State Street in tears, going to the state capitol with signs and blocking traffic and say, this can't happen. They have to listen to us. We can't have Trump 4 more years. And then you say, how did you vote? Well, I didn't. Or I voted for Jill Stein. There are only two choices, Trump or Harris. And it's time to choose. 855-75. Truth, wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the All Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 9 before the hour of 1 o'clock, coming up in hour 2, another edition of What's Worse? Have you seen this story, Zomers, about Bath, what is it? Bath and Body Works have a new candle for the holidays.
I have not, but now I'm concerned.
You should be. Somebody at marketing to Bath and Body Works needs to rethink things. Anyway, what's worse coming up in hour number 2, a little more lighter take on things. Over the break, talking about here, these comments by Trump over the weekend gotten darker, the rhetoric, what this means, what we're headed towards and on the 5th, on election day, November 5th, 22 days away. Trump isn't talking right now to win votes. He's talking to rile the public up, to increase his crowds, to lay the groundwork, to declare victory, whether he legitimately wins, which he could, on November 5th or not. And then create chaos and go into the courts. And I'm not trying to scare anyone. I'm just trying to inform. I want people to clearly understand what is at stake and why it's important to register to vote, to have a plan to vote, as our friend Luke Mathers likes to say, and to be a voter. And why writing someone, if you're not happy with Trump, if you're concerned about Trump, if you would get to the 6th or 7th or whatever we find out who the winner is, and if you would be unhappy with Donald Trump in the White House for 4 more years, why the only alternative this election is Kamala Harris and Tim Walz. I'm all for fusion voting and ranked choice voting and more parties in the future. And I get it. People, especially young people, have told me, Todd, why does it always have to be in the future? I think we're making progress, in my opinion. I think in another 4 to 8 years, you could truly have a third-party candidate that has a legitimate shot. But that's not going to happen in the next 22 days. And if Trump ends up in the White House, there is at least a realistic chance, based on things that he has said or helped author in Project 2025, that lead me to believe, and others who are a lot smarter than me to believe, that many of our fundamental tenets of democracy will be at risk. And that's why I don't understand this certain segment, not all, but a certain segment of the progressive Democratic left who've got their nose out of joint because Kamala Harris has the audacity to create a coalition with principled Republicans like Liz Cheney. Matt, listening on WAUK in Germantown, says, why is it bad to get other opinions? That's how democracy works. I agree. I absolutely agree, Matt. It doesn't, and again, it doesn't mean you have to do everything that someone tells you. But just get other opinions. Abraham Lincoln was famous for that. Brought people in who hated him, despised him, tried to defeat him, brought him into the cabinet. Because he wanted to get a variety of ideas. 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. Kurt in Madison. Kurt, thanks for calling. What say you?
Yeah, this was discussed on Tom Hartman's show, and actually I had brought this up earlier with friends, saying why is Trump spending so much time in blue states where he doesn't have a chance to win? Well, he's doing it because the media keeps on saying it's the polls are tied. And that way, when he loses the blue states, he can immediately say, see, the whole thing was rigged. We were tied all the way to the end, and now I lost. So there's a lot of threads going on, way beyond just the ones you covered and the one I mentioned now. But yeah. You're absolutely right. In the end, the whole impetus of this is to throw the votes out and have it handed over to the legislators for to decide. We know how that's going to go down.
Yeah, I basically agree with you, Kurt. Right. I mean, Trump doesn't expect to win California. He knows he's not going to win California. But you're right. He's trying to get as many media markets, trying to gin up the crowds as much as he can to say, look at all this coverage. Look at all these people. I couldn't have possibly lost. And it's a psychology thing, right? Appreciate you calling, Kurt. Let's leave it here. On the wackier side. And finally, people are coming around to, oh, geez, maybe Trump is a little bit too old to be president. Here's from one of the speeches over the weekend. He thinks there's a conspiracy against cows and windows.
Just come up. They want to do things like no more cows and no windows in buildings. They have some wonderful plans for this country.
What? What?
You think that was on the teleprompter? I don't think so.
That's part of their speech. Well done, Summers. Say, accusing Democrats and Harris Walls that they want to get rid of cows and windows.
I think it is abundantly clear that we cannot take anything this man says seriously anymore.
Well, I think, yeah, yes. But also, legitimately, there are some real issues about his mental acuity and stability here.
Right. That's more what I mean.
And you know as well as I do, everybody. It doesn't matter who you think you're going to vote for or plan to vote for. Again, I want everybody to vote. Every American citizen to vote. Let me clarify that because somebody will bring that back at me. You know that nobody's trying to ban cows. Or ban windows. Do you really want that guy to have the nuclear codes? What's worse on the other side? Don't go anywhere. Hour two is straight ahead. You're listening to the Todd Allball Show, and you're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.